Okay, welcome to our demonstration day. We have a lot of ground to cover, and it's very exciting. And I think the most important, well, there's a lot of important things we're going to cover. One of the most important is that we first showed this phenomena of this extremely, extremely high power, very, very high light emitting events back in January 28th in 2014. Then we had an anniversary of that this past January, but we never really talked about what the energy balance was and power balance. We just said it's, as you can see by inspection, it's phenomenally powerful. But then the question is, how much power are we putting in to create that effect? And then other things, has it been validated? And we're going to talk about five validations with four methodologies and actually present those validations today, at least three of them in real time and with real analysis. And what those validations show is that we're creating on the order of 1 million watts in the volume of a coffee cup. And that's a lot better than a Tempest in a teapot. And so the more important thing is the input power is very low in comparison. It's on the order of up to 100 times less power. So it's phenomenal power gain, and it's phenomenal unprecedented power densities. And then the question is, can you commercialize it? Because we show a single vent is very, very powerful. And then we have engineering systems that will sustain those events, as we talked about in the January 28th presentation, and different designs. But now we actually have a commercial design and full engineering drawings. And you can see here we prototyped it already in stainless steel, which can't withstand those kinds of powers. You'll see they melt through very quickly. And you'll see that today. But the data acquisition systems we have are very, very fast. And they're on the order of billionths of a second. So we get many, many recordings to analyze how this is going to perform when it's out in the field. I'll give you a timeline. In particular, we think we're on track for commercial timeline, and we're looking for the first half of 2017 to deploy 100 kilowatt type electric devices. So I'll show you how we've progressed to that as we go forward. So the agenda is, I'm going to present a little bit of background, and then we're going to cut to the lab, and they're going to run a number of methodologies. It'll come back to me while they're processing data and getting the SunCell ready, so that when the SunCell is ready to run, they'll cut back and video it in. I'll take questions at that time. Then they'll run the SunCell and present data while they work up the data for the SunCell, and then we'll see that data and then go back to the business presentation, which is all important of how we're going to commercialize it, what the markets look like, and what the strategy is. And in very, very summary type terms, if you wanted to say it in a few sentences, our goal is to create a series of devices on the order of 100 to 250 kilowatt scale, go completely off grid, autonomous of grid, autonomous of fuel, give plurality of units to mitigate any interruption of service, and sell power extremely cheap with no pollution and extremely more capable than any known power source. So with that, I'll and the way we plan to execute that is through lease agreements on a per diem basis. No net metering, no metering at all. Just a straight up equipment lease at a very, very discounted price relative to current power. We plan to outsource the engineering to some extent, supply chain management, manufacturing, installation, depot repair, and maintenance. So our primary business, which is very low risk, is to execute these lease agreements for power equipment on a per diem basis. So I'll go a little bit into the science, and I know this is going to be hard, but if you bear with me, because it relates to how we're doing the validation. So fundamentally, going back and reviewing this, there's a premise. In fact, there's a strong debate in the earliest part of the 20th century whether the electron was really real or whether it was purely some creation of your mind, that reality was all in your mind, and whether you collapsed the wave function and the universe being mathematical and there not existing an exact physical world. And I think it's obvious there's a physical world. I mean, this is made out of atoms. I mean, you got to get real. I mean, things are what they are. I mean, all math aside, you can crank out numbers, and if that's the game you're in as an academician, in the real world, you have to engineer things, and they have to work, and you have to predict things. So, so this starts with the basic physical laws, and actually, for the first time, or well, it's been a while since I've done it, but it's led to extraordinary results, including the technology you're going to witness today. But the premise is quite simple. Physically solve what fundamental particles are. Don't treat them as singularities everywhere at once. They don't exist until you take some kind of derivative or turn on a spectrometer, because the spectrometer is not creating what you're looking at. It was there. You're just observing it. So I think current modern theory turns physics on its head. You can't even describe it as physics. It's just mathematics and philosophy. So that's why it's been hard to get acceptance as technology, because it's not that I'm not using very rigorous approaches, that we're not using extraordinary methods and rigor in our measurements. It's that it overthrows the current paradigm in physics. And it's the bar has been going higher and higher. It's gotten to the point when you have a commercial device and you're wiping out coal, oil, gas, nuclear, solar, wind, geothermal, hydro, biomass, utilities, internal combustion engine, electric vehicles, you know, and batteries, and on, then we'll take this seriously. So that's kind of like where the bar is, and that's fine, because we're going to show you we're on a trajectory to do that. So this is a little complicated, but I wanted to show you that you can describe precisely, absolutely, no uncertainty, what an electron really is and how it moves in space and time, and it reproduces everything that's been measured on it to a high precision as can be measured in the fundamental constant of nature, and that's very, very high. You can solve very, very complicated problems like DNA and insulin and know the solution to every single electron, every single bond to is that high a precision, and what the charge distribution is in those bonds. We've, of course, compared it to nature, and here's 415 molecules with a calculated and experimental identically matching on that line to the limit of measurement, and we compare that to the advanced quantum mechanical approach, and you can see it's woefully inferior. So the other thing quantum says, you can't visualize molecules, and in fact you can, and they're getting higher and higher resolution. And this is what they call atomic force microscopy image using carbonyl molecule as a probe, if that means anything to the scientists. And it makes a very good rendering of pentacene. And this is the overlay of that from the solution. And it gets all the bond distance and bond angles and energies to a part per 100,000. And it's a very good rendering. You can see here the hydrogen the molecular orbitals of hydrogen here, and the bonds of carbon-carbon and the like. And it works out very, very well for the level resolution they can get, and it's getting better. So those types of powerful theoretical predictions and calculations predict a new form of energy, and that is hydrogen going to a more stable chemical state. The current theory precludes that because they mathematically define that, whatever it means. Define it. I mean, you can't really define. I mean, I would define $1 million in my bank, or you know, we could put enough in our bank that we wouldn't need to have these meetings. But I can't define that any more than I can define what the energy level of the electron is. So it assumes what energy level. It assumes based on physical principles. And so here's a hydrogen atom, this blue guy. And what you need is something that can accept the energy an exact match. And it can't transfer the energy by light, so it has to have some kind of chemical process and through space energy transfer. And that's pretty common. Power generation uses that principle. Phosphorescent lighting uses that. Many examples in nature are based on the energy transfer not evolving light through space. And the energy is very high, the amount of energy transferred, higher than the what they call the binding energy, or the energy it takes to rip electron off of any known atom or molecule. So the actual process is energy transfer, and then these electrons get ionized. That means they get positive, create positive ions and negative electrons that are free. And as you know from getting static electricity build up when you go across the rug in a dry room and touch a filing cabinet, you feel that shock. Hurts. Well, it doesn't build up to infinity and burn your arm off. It's because it's limiting, because you build up your energy level changes as you get accumulate charge. Same way with these reactions. And the way to get this reaction to have extraordinary high rate is to dissipate this charge with something called an arc current state. It's a state of matter where the higher the current, the lower the energy of the system. So it's positively driving itself. So once that energy transfer occurs, this ionization occurs, this atom then drops down to a lower state and releases additional energy to that that was transferred to the catalyst. And we can measure the ionization of the catalyst. We can measure this energy that's released in terms of continuum radiation, which is truly unique, characteristic of and identifies this hydrino process. So we apply this arc current, and after years and years and years of theory and work and predicting everything from subatomic particle masses to the acceleration and expansion of the cosmos and many observations, all coming true. I haven't seen a single one that hasn't, and it's an incredibly comprehensive amount of theory that's been derived and solved. You put that arc current on, and you get explosive kinetics, extremely high power. And then you might say, well, how high power is that? Well, we just did one of those last week. We had some people in, and we had the five validators in, and we did that with quantitative spectroscopy using a National Institute of Standards and Technology light source to calibrate our instruments. And last week we got, let me play that again, we got that blast is 5 million watts of light. And what's extraordinary is it's essentially all in the short wavelength region. So this is some data we published before, and we ran it on the Harvard-Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics, their spectrometer. We've ran it a number of different places. This is a real spectrum continuum radiation with a 10.1 nanometer cutoff. What's that mean? Well, that means it's really super high energy, and it matches theory predictions exactly. That's where it's supposed to have the highest energy emission. So that's the highest energy light that can come off, and then you get it to lesser energy or longer wavelengths thereafter, which proves that is another proof of the theory. So it turns out that radiation is coming from all over the sky, including dark matter forming regions. And you might say, what the heck is that, dark matter? It sounds like some Halloween thing. So it turns out, or maybe like a new action figure or something on the movies, this dark matter man. So, but actually, it turns out it makes up most of the mass of the universe. Dark matter is something that you can see by gravitational effects, like this galaxy is not really there. It's being gravitationally lensed. That means the space is bent because of the gravity, and the light's traveling in a non-straight path. And we can see that coming into the telescope, even though it's not there. It's in some other part of the universe. How do you know that? You just turn the telescope and it go away. Just a little bit different angle. So, and it's got some unusual shape. So this is ring is dark matter. Everything else is hydrogen, more or less. So the universe is made of hydrogen that you can see. And what I'm saying is this is hydrogen you can't see because it makes the same kind of mission as what we're seeing in the lab. And now the astrophysicists are agreeing that, or they're saying that the only thing, like in science and top journals, The only thing dark matter can be, based on it being intergalactic and acting like hydrogen when it collides, is hydrogen. So the stuff you can't see that makes up 100 times more mass than what you can see is hydrogen, and that's what we're making. We're making hydrogen that emits continuum radiation, 10.1 nanometer cutoff, and you can't see it thereafter. But you can do a lot of other analytical tests, so visible or other types of what they call electronic excitation spectrum you can't see, but you can see rotation, vibration, ionization. We got 15 analytical tests that show we have this new form of hydrogen. I'll just show this exists. And we've had many experts look at this, and they agree. We've had it run at the instrument manufacturers. We had it run at numbers of universities. This peak, with only one single peak in the spectrum, matches the rotational energy of the corresponding molecule from that reaction perfectly. There's other examples of that. And then we can look at the vibration rotation. So this curve shape and these lines exactly where the red is like one in an infinity probability that you'd see this. There's nothing known to man occurs in this energy region. And it's the same energy as the spacing here is corresponds to the same energy what I showed you before with that single rotational peak and that other technique. So this is the vibration and rotation of that hydrino molecule that's a product of our reaction. It shows up after we run it, as does this peak, where we ionize the molecule and we can look at the total energy of the electrons binding into that molecule. And it turns out it's 500 electron volts versus 31 electron volts for ordinary hydrogen, exactly as predicted. Enormous amount of energy release, and that's the minimum amount. So we can get hundreds to thousands of times more energy than conventional chemical reactions from this process. And this has been run at a number of universities on top instrumentation. Their computers can't assign it anything known and matches identical theoretical calculations. So we're going to examine this reaction again. Let's revisit it in a number of these validations. So the first one we have is calorimetry, and this is an instrument. It's called a PAR-1341, what they call a bomb calorimeter. Bomb meaning you have one big blast, and then the reaction chamber is immersed or submerged in a water bath, and the heat from that reaction gets absorbed in that water, and the water is in a thermos. So all that heat is retained inside the instrument, and then you measure how much the water warms up. And there's something called specific heat and heat capacity, very well known, that it takes so many units of energy to raise the temperature a given amount. So then you know how many units of energy based on the temperature raise. So that's the instrument. There's Maria there running it. She's going to happily, excitedly run that for us today. The instrument's inside this environmental chamber, and then here's all the analytical instrumentation. And we have a lot of spectroscopy equipment. In fact, we have probably one of the best spectrometers going in terms of high-speed resolution of very energetic events, like measuring blasts and the like. Energetic materials. We have that equipment that was built by one of the top experts, helped us build that. So we have the latest generation of that technology. So we can look at the ultraviolet to the infrared, and then we have another one that looks in the middle, what they call extreme ultraviolet range, and then we have this one in the foreground, so that's in the middle. This one does the UV to the infrared. This one does the middle extreme ultraviolet, and this does the really, really short extreme ultraviolet, what we call high energy vacuum ultraviolet. So we can cover the whole entire range from the extremely high even to the heat wavelengths. And what's really remarkable, which everyone's like stunned by this, so here you can see visible wavelengths, just to let you know, this is a graph of the basically the energy or power. Power released, and then this is the wavelengths. And the wavelengths give you relate to how much energy the light has. So the visible is up in this region, and what you'll see here is there's essentially no visible, there's essentially no infrared. So you're getting extremely high energy light with no heat or no regular light, which is amazing. And the only way I've seen that you can create this kind of thing was like hundreds of millions of dollar instrument that you trap these like over 10 times ionized ions with huge magnetic fields and like hundreds of megawatts of power. And even that, it's very, very difficult to reproduce that spectrum. I mean, this is at atmospheric pressure, and it's at basically when blasted, it's at room temperature. So it's just unbelievable to get all enormously high. And you say, well, how high is that? It's 527,000 watts of what they call soft X-ray or extreme ultraviolet. That lithography people die. I mean, they're using free electron lasers as big as this building to create those kind of wavelengths to make chips. I mean, this is huge powers at huge wavelengths and no visible or infrared. So it's very, very unique in terms of the radiation emits. We're going to show that today. Then there's another validation we do based on one of the best guys I know that I've ever met in terms of heat transfer. And I had this intuition. If you took the water cooling coil that we have, it serves also as the radio frequency antenna to heat up the silver metal that we inject into electrodes of fire to make this reaction go. And I'll explain more later. But I felt, well, you know, if we looked at the cooling, the water cooling loop temperature, and if it doubled, I would think it would take twice as much power to make the water go up, rise twice as fast. And he did a mathematical model, and it proves that. So basically, this is showing that if you have twice the power, the water in the coolant loop, the heat exchanger loop, will heat up twice as fast. And that makes sense. So therefore, if you knew how much wattage you're putting in when it was warming up at a certain rate, and now you have it warming up at another rate, if you just took the ratio and multiplied by that wattage, you would get to what the wattage is now that it's turned on the hydrino process. So it turns out that that gives us a very high number. This is the last one we ran. Here, I'll show you. First equipment. So there's a water coolant loop. So here's a copper pipe, quarter-inch copper pipes, tubing, and it brings in water, goes around the cell, and then comes back out. So we look at the temperature rise in versus out. We look at the temperature rise per time, and then compare that before and after we turn on the hydrino reaction, and we multiply that change in slope, that ratio in slope, by the input wattage before we turn the hydrino process on, and we get the output power. And here we have the pre-slope, post-slope, and it's 188 times higher after we turn the hydrino process on. And we are putting in about 6.6 kilowatts before we turned it on. And now you multiply that number about 200 times that, you get 1.2 megawatts, million watts of power. So very, very high. All right, so we're going to cut now to the validators. They're going to run spectroscopy and measure power using a National Institutes and Standards and Technology calibrated spectrometer. They're going to do the calorimetry I showed you. They're going to do the spectrum in the high energy region and tell you what the total light output is. And then we're going to come back and get the data from them when the when the SunCell is running, and you can watch that, and then we'll go over all the data and then go back to the business. So I'll come back and do business presentation. We'll interrupt it, and then I'll return to that. All right, so Mark, you can cut them over. This is Johnny Luktowski is going to take you through this. Johnny, you want to take it over?
Yes. Hello, everybody. How are you today? All right. So what we have here is behind me, we have the hardware set up. We have a vacuum flange that has our sample loaded into it. It is it's a hydrated oxide metal sample. And over here, we have a vacuum tube running to a Ariba spectrometer with a fast time resolution, a CCD camera. So at the moment, we've set up this equipment to acquire a blast, and we are going to take a look at the light signal off it. And Richard behind me is going to ignite the sample in just a moment, and we will get the data file here and take a quick look at it before we process it. So we're set up to go. So Richard, go ahead and trigger. So we grab the sample. We can see here it says the file's been grabbed, and now we have a signal file. So I'm going to close the acquisition window and just take a really fast look at the data. And we do see here we have an image that is mostly black except for where we see some light emission. And this camera was set to 40 microsecond exposure, and so this represents a number of frames at 40 microseconds. And we'll move to another experiment, but when we come back to this, we'll take a look at how that emission looks after we data process it. So, Mark, I'm going to move over to the calorimeter station and sign off this one, and I'll be back with you in a moment. Okay, we're back, and we're at the calorimeter station now, and behind us we have the calorimeter in an environmental chamber here, and we have the spot welder to ignite the fuel sample just right outside the environmental chamber, and it has some bus bars running inside the bomb calorimeter. This is a standard 1341 PAR bomb calorimeter, and I'm going to share the desktop out now. So you can see our screen. And what we have here is we have the acquisition of the temperature of the bomb calorimeter, and it's measured to a resolution of 1 millikelvin for the temperature. And we also have a VI set up to acquire the voltage and current signals that we put into the system. So Maria here is going to go ahead and set off the ignition. Okay, so we have successfully acquired the signal, the input signals for voltage and current. And now we will go back to the temperature screen. And we can see the temperature of the system, of the bomb calorimeter, beginning to respond. And this is going to take approximately 15 to 20 minutes to develop this until the temperature stops rising and crests over. So while we're doing that, we're going to move back into the spectroscopy area, and at the moment it's being changed from the MITx spectrometer to the normal incident spectrometer, and it may be another couple minutes till we get that spectrometer on, but as soon as we have that on and are ready to fire another shot, we'll be back with you in another few minutes.
Yeah, while we're waiting, do you have any questions so far? Does anybody have any questions? All right, whenever you do, just let me know and I'll be here to answer. Getting set up for the spectroscopy.
Yeah. Just, are you already in the continuous power generation mode, or is it?
Yes, continuous generation. We're going to show that. Million watt scale until it melts.
So I presume the melting is not a good thing, right?
Once it's made out of refractory materials, it should handle it. Yeah, you have to have that kind of power density in order to maintain the cell at the temperature we need for power conversion. So we're going to heat it up at very, very high temperature. It's basically an enormous incandescent light bulb that will illuminate photovoltaic cells with. So it has to be very hot. So you need very high power density, which this is uniquely capable of.
Can you talk a little bit, Randy, about how you plan to manage oxidation of the refractory materials?
Yeah, I'll go into it. We're going to, on the, there'll be no chemical in there that is capable of oxidizing the refractory material.
So water will not be the catalyst? It'll be.
we're going to generate it in situ. Right. It would be very extremely stable oxygen source, and we're going to supply hydrogen. Extremely stable oxygen source. Won't react with the any metals.
So no free oxygen at all.
That's right. No free or no chemically capable, reactive capable oxygen source. And then a steady oxygen inventory. So it's got a fixed oxygen inventory. Hydrogen's going to be flowed in and permeated through the black body radiator dome. It's very permeable at that high temperature.
Some of that oxygen will strip off the hydrogen will strip off the oxygen and create the H2O. That'll provide the catalyst. Reaction.
That's correct.
And the oxygen goes back to the solid form.
Yes, that's correct.
How far away is it from having a reactor that goes about gas?
We have the design. We're going to do more testing of it and then have it built. We have a company that built the entire thing out of tungsten. So all the parts, the joints, connections, penetrations have been designed and built into sophisticated engineering drawings. And then we prototyped it in stainless steel. And I'm going to show a run of it later. So we're getting that timeline worked out, but it's probably on the order of a month to 2 months, something like that, from the time we give them the green light. And then we have the photovoltaic technology has also been developed, the cells and what they call the dense receiver array, and we have a 4-month timetable or time frame for delivery of that. So the fabricate the photovoltaic chips, run the wafers, and do the metal organic continuous vapor deposition to make the photovoltaic cells, and to fabricate them into the dense receiver array, which is going to be a geodesic dome that goes around the black body radiator dome, which is this dome up here. And I'll explain that more when I show the engineering drawings. That'll go around that and convert the extremely high energy, high power flux of light into electricity. So we're going to use what they call concentrator photovoltaics that run somewhere between 1,000 and 2,000 suns initially, and they're running in the lab up to 10,000 suns, 10,000 times conventional illumination in say solar farms, conventional solar panels.
What's the timeline?
4 months.
Randy, is there any ongoing effort to move up the energy spectrum to capture that light at higher energies?
They do direct conversion of the EUV?
EUV, yeah.
Yeah, we do. We have a program, very big program at one of the leading universities to do that, and we already have 6 devices fabricated that we're testing now.
Do you see a timeline for that yet, or is it too early to say?
I think it depends if it's going to be any advantage. I'll explain more about the photovoltaic here, but the photovoltaic cells that we're using with a triple junction, they're projected to be about 38% efficiency, and then we're going to add infrared reflectors, which you can uniquely do, which you can't do with solar because if it reflects, it goes back to the sun, but we can reflect infrared wavelengths with a longer wavelength, non-convertible light back to the radiator, and then it'll bounce back. So we can get multiple bounce, and that'll drive the efficiency very, very high. You can't multiple bounce that short wavelength light.
Would you consider it aggressive to consider mass production prior to being able to run one of these continuously in a lab for an extended period of time? Not really. You have reactors that are melting down now on a pretty regular basis. Wouldn't it be wise to just run this in a lab continuously for a period of time prior to?
Well, that would be, yes, that's part of the field trial. Once we prototype it in refractory metals, there's no reason why it can't run indefinitely. It has no moving parts. It has electromagnetic pump. It has supercapacitor-driven ignition source, and we're converting with photovoltaic, no moving parts. So all the parts that we have are they're literally a decade or decades in the field, maintenance, pretty much maintenance free. So Once you get the power densities and achieve the parameters to achieve the temperatures that are required for the spectrum that we're projecting for photovoltaic conversion, there's really not much more to engineer. If it works in stainless, it's the same system. All the joints, the big issue with it is the joints, the penetrations, and how to fabricate it. And we think we've already solved all those problems, and we've already prototyped it in stainless, and we're running it. So then we just make it in high temperature refractory materials. That's probably something I can show you. So the issue of melting is, let me show you an example. So we're going to have this dome, which is a black body radiator, that we're going to heat up to somewhere between 3,000 and 3,500 Kelvin. So to give you an idea what that looks like, we have a halogen light bulb. So this is the same temperature. And then you might say, well, how much heat, how do you keep that at that temperature without melting? And it turns out it's like a spring. So as you compress the spring, it's very, very easy. But once the spring gets very, very compressed, that incremental displacement is very, very hard to do. So when things get hot like a coffee cup, they take a long time to cool down because they're transferring heat by convection and conduction. They're transferring the heat into the table or the surrounding air. But this is transferring essentially all the power by emitting light. So this is 150 watts. And you turn it off and see it's dark immediately. It's not cooling like a coffee cup over hours. So it's on and off immediately. So what it says is the power in is matching the power out. It's losing. Very, very high rate in terms of light. So light's extremely efficient at removing power. So that power is going to flow to the photovoltaic converter. So it's not like something like a piece of metal, you heat it up until it melts. That's still pretty low temperature. When you're in this regime, these refractory metals, it's so incredibly hot, it's emitting almost all the power by light. There's something called the Stefan-Boltzmann law that says the power emitted from a black body radiator, which we're creating, is the temperature to the fourth power. So it's like exponentially fast by emitting by the light emission path. So that's the regime we're in. So for it to go incrementally higher in temperature, it's going to take an enormously large amount of power excursion to do that. So it self-protects itself, because if it goes incrementally higher, it's going to immediately radiate at a much higher rate and prevent it from rising in temperature.
Why not try to capture some of the heat? There's so much heat and energy being produced that it's sensible to dump the heat.
Yeah, our model right now is just to dump it. And I'll show you what the spectrum looks like. A black body radiator has some visible light, like this has some visible light, but this light bulb also has a lot of heat. So the heat is part of the spectrum that gets converted with a photovoltaic cell. Even ordinary cells are radiated with the heat of the sun. And then it converts some fraction of that. So the light coming from the sun is heat as well. And the light coming into concentrator photovoltaics, it basically have a parabolic dish the size of, say, half a football field. They could be that big, but typically are maybe 10 meters across. You could concentrate it into a focal point about the size of a wallet. And that'll burn, that's so much concentrated heat, it'll burn through a quarter-inch steel like in 10 seconds. You'll see our cell burn through quarter-inch steel in seconds. So it's in both cases, you're looking at extraordinary high density of light that has heat in it. That's part of the nature of the power in photovoltaic conversion. What's unique about our process, our design, is that the light that goes through the PV panel or through the cells in the PV panel that's not converted to electricity can be bounced back. So the long wavelengths can be bounced back to that dome and reheat it, and then it'll have some fraction of visible and some fraction of infrared, and it'll go back, go through the PV cells and bounce back again. And then we'll have a what they call a halogen cycle. The halogen bulb can run at much higher temperatures. As you run at much higher temperatures, you can have the tungsten vaporize. All metals at any temperature have some vapor pressure, albeit nominally low at low temperatures. But as it gets higher, you'll have vapor pressure metal. That's how they do vapor deposition. They heat up a metal, it makes metal atoms, and then they deposit onto your substrate, the material, the surface of the material you want to coat with that metal. So there's something called the halogen cycle that was invented for the halogen light bulb. So they could run at much higher temperatures, so you would have much more visible light of that inventory of light. So the light is invisible, and then you have some infrared or heat wavelengths or heat portion of that light as well. The halogen lamp takes advantage of that black body curve relationship in that the hotter it is, the more visible proportion of visible you get. And that's a better product because you're looking at the lamp as a source of illumination. So it runs hotter. And as it runs hotter, you're going to get more vapor pressure, but the halogen atoms that are in there react with that tungsten and redeposit back onto the filament. In this case, it'll redeposit back on the dome. And that's very, very well established technology.
Out of the energy that's produced, how much is heat and how much is light?
Of ours?
Yeah, what's the ratio?
Of the total light power coming from it, if we use three junctions, that's three different layers of photovoltaic material that convert different regions of the spectrum into light. If we use that, we can get up over 30% efficiency. We have some calculations that show 38% efficiency, and then if you use the infrared reflectors, you can go much higher than that.
I'm trying to ascertain how much energy you're dumping in the form of heat relative to the amount of energy that you're retaining.
Well, in all heat conversion devices, turbines maybe 30, 40%, so you're dumping 60%. It's sort of the same scenario here. When you convert from the source of power into electricity, whether it be thermal, producing steam and running a mechanical system, or in this case, making light and converting that light into electricity, you're looking at dumping the majority of the power as heat.
Even with the bounce back system, Randy, or will you start to go?
You know what, it doesn't matter. I mean, even if it's at the power gains we're getting, it really, really is irrelevant. You just scale it to the scale you need and you look at the capital cost. The capital cost is about $60 kilowatt electric and you're just dumping some heat. Internal combustion engine, same thing. Most of it's just dumped heat.
Randy, you mentioned earlier just about a 200 multiplier for watts in. I think it was about 6 watts going in and 1.2 gigs coming out. Is that measure of the 1.2 gigawatts, the 30% captured through the light.
Well, whatever light you have coming, you say you have a megawatt of light coming out, and then you're going to capture about 40% of that. What learned out technology capture about 40% of that in electricity. So you have about 400,000 watts from megawatt of light, and then you're dumping about 600,000 watts of heat. You can use that heat, but the 600,000 watts of heat is really not worth that much because you're dumping it out of the photovoltaic cooling system. So it really gets down to what does it cost you per kilowatt hour for electricity? And it's less than a tenth of a cent per kilowatt hour. So the capital cost is about $60 a kilowatt, and that's basically all your costs. You have no fuel costs. You have about 2% operation maintenance cost, and then the rest is just amortization of capital cost. So you take the $60 a kilowatt and over a 20-year lifespan of the PV, which is the major cost. PV is essentially all the costs, as I'll show. If you amortize that over 20 years, you're looking at $3 a kilowatt electric capital cost. And then you're looking at you're like a buck. You know, it's phenomenally small. Maybe like a buck a kilowatt a year operation maintenance cost. Extremely, extremely small. So, Mark, what's going on there? You wanted me to go back and do the business presentation? All right, let me just kind of proceed, and then we'll just come back to it. All right. They're going to come back with the extreme ultraviolet spectrum and show you that here in a second. I'll go into some of the business because it seems like there's a lot of interest in it. So let's go on with that. And then I'll explain again. So we got some background. I'll explain more. So you got that point. Essentially, all conversion of a power source, whether it's internal combustion or whether it's central power generation, coal, gas, oil, even solar. If you're going for the input power into output electricity is typically 40% at best, and the rest of the energy is lost. That's just the nature of generating electricity. So then the question is, do you want to use that waste heat? And the economics of it is that it doesn't make sense to even use it. We had some analysis. Well, we'd take a heat exchanger and we'd run some sort of a heat transfer system, and then have some heat exchanger in a building. But it's absolutely cheaper just to generate more electricity and run resistive heating. You can run it everywhere you want. It's incredibly versatile. You're looking at less than a tenth of a cent per kilowatt hour to generate. That's what it costs. And it will cost you more for the capital equipment to run all the plumbing and the pumping and the controls and the heat exchangers than it is just to run straight wire and just heat with electrical heat. So you have to get over the mindset that you have to conserve energy. It's going to be tough, but people, it's just ubiquitous, and it's as easy to get as the air out of the atmosphere. You just don't worry about it.
Am I thinking about this right? $60 per kilowatt. So I pay $60 and I get 1 kilowatt. That's the capital cost.
Yes.
And then.
Well, you don't buy it. We're going to lease it to you at per diem rate.
So buy it or lease it. I pay $60. I get 1 kilowatt hour.
No, you get 1 kilowatt of capacity that'll probably last 20 years before you have to exchange out the photovoltaic panels. That means if you have a 10 kilowatt house, that's $600 for your power source for your house for like 20 years. It'll generate all the electricity you need. It's really cheap. I mean, it's and you'll see.
Brandy, that's your cost. That's not what you're saying.
Right. We're going to charge a per diem rate, but I'm just saying it's the capital equipment cost is very small. You use the hydrogen source is water vapor from the atmosphere or dump water in it. And to give you an idea, minimally, it's a gallon of water, put it in gallons. A gallon of water is like 200 to 1,000 gallons of gasoline equipment. It's kind of depending on how we run the reactor. It's huge amount of energy density in the fuel. All right, I'm going to answer a lot of questions. Let me go through this, and I can probably answer a lot of your questions. So, I know it's on a lot of people's mind. Do you want some of the lights off? Maybe the lights are up front here, just on the front. Whatever. See that better? Can everybody hear me okay?
Yep.
Okay, good. All right, so we have a lot of people's minds is the CO2 scenario, and power demand's going up, and we're still going to be carbon-based, even in the 2040 predominantly. Electric vehicles aren't going to amount to much in terms of CO2 from vehicles, and they're still majority charge from carbon-based fuel sources. So there's a lot of invention of a lot of industries going on now, like the taxi industry and telecom and advertising through social media, and a lot of things are undergoing disruption right now. And this is one of the most important inventions. In fact, I was watching, I don't know if you can watch it, Fareed Zakaria or not, but he was saying that actually all this stuff with social media and smartphones and personal computers has very little impact on the economy. What do you think had the most impact? Most impact. Electricity. Internal combustion. Aviation. All of which we're going to influence. They had a bit, that's why modern society is what it is today. Those were so incredibly wealth-creating technologies, they're unfathomable compared to anything ever since. And that's the whole point. They're saying if you want to grow the world's economy, have all these flat growth rates, you need to do something like reinvent electricity. That will cause the economy to blast off like a rocket. So, yes. We go? Okay, let's go back. Spectroscopy.
Hello, I'm Ying. I'm going to show you
to acquire with normal incident spectrometer. Over there, it will cover the wavelength range from 100 nanometer to 350 nanometer. The sample is in the vacuum. Now we are ready to acquire the sample spectrum. You are too fast. It missed the spectrum. We'll reload the sample.
All right, let me go back to business then. Okay, Ying, we'll come back. Yeah, we got to come back with the CG as well and then process the data. So let's just work it in while I give the talk. We'll just kind of work these experiments in when they're ready. Okay, so we have a new sustainable non-polluting. Not only is it superior in all categories in power density and versatility and independence of the grid and fuels infrastructure, it doesn't have a pollution of any kind. We have validation from 5 independent validators, 4 methodologies, enormous amount of patents filed, and we're looking at ourselves as an electricity company, and we're going to lease equipment on a per diem basis, no metering, partner, outsource everything except for the leasing, as I said earlier, and we're going for a timeline. We're working on a timeline of field trials, first half of 2017. Enormous implications for the world in terms of access and affordability of electricity. So it's a continuous process, and as I was saying, it has this hydrino or more stable form of hydrogen as the byproduct. So you don't have a coal combustion or a gas combustion. This is so it's chemical, and you have like fission with the uranium and whatnot. You have the water dropping by gravity through a turbine. So this is hydrogen of water molecules going to hydrino form or dark matter form of hydrogen, and it releases much higher power density and energy than conventional technologies. So it's a new power source. Capital cost is between $50 and $100 a kilowatt, depends on volume, and that compares very well relative to other sources of power like solar. There's no net metering. We're planning on selling at 5 cents a kilowatt hour and giving twice the capacity as the historical peaks. So we'll have redundant units to mitigate disruption, and extremely low operating cost and maintenance. It takes a nominal amount of water as a source of fuel, the particular hydrogen from the water molecules. And it's scalable, and we're looking to make units from 10 kW to 10 megawatt. And as I was saying, we're looking for a relatively rapid build out. So we started this in, because I've been criticized before, and I'll make a comment about that since I have a chance to defend myself. This took an enormous amount of theory, and it took an enormous amount of analytical, enormous amount of work. And when we broke through in terms of getting the kinetics where it could make a commercial product, that was around, first demonstration was January 28, 2014. We're looking at product into 2017. I think that's pretty good. So we're moving very, very quickly, and there was a lot of problems we have to solve. And this looks all easy, but I can tell you, there was a lot of things that had to be worked out, and they are. And it's the prospects look extraordinarily good for a fast deployment of this. So current power, just to give you an idea of the economics, for every watt, it generates about $1 revenue. So you have 1 million watts, that makes about $1 million a year's revenue. Of course, you got fuel costs, but high capital costs with traditional power sources. That's just in general. And the capital cost is about $60 a kilowatt electric. It's got about a 20-year lifespan. So annually, over that 20 years, it's $3 a kilowatt. Very, very competitive. Low operation maintenance cost, about 2% of capital cost. And your generation cost is basically amortization of this cost, which is phenomenally low. And that's even conservative. It's actually less than 1/10 of a cent per kilowatt hour to generate. So, as I'll show in the next slides, predominantly the cost is the cost of the photovoltaic converter. And if you go above 100 kW, that is, At a certain scale, the PV becomes a dominant cost component. And of course, the PV is dependent on volume. If you're about 100 million watts per year of PV fabrication, you're about $75 a kilowatt at 2,000 suns. If you go 10,000 suns, it comes down dramatically. If you go 10 gigawatt annual production, you're looking at $32 per kilowatt at 2,000 suns. So that can be get really, really cheap. So this is a breakdown of the bill of materials and their relative cost. And this is a 250 kilowatt, and this is the cost. Now, here's an important thing. So this is a first of a kind for 250 kW. So if you went out and bought these parts, it would cost you $30,000 for 250 kilowatt, or a little over about $112, something like that, per kilowatt. First of a kind. Then you get into mass production, this will come down dramatically. So I think very conservatively, $60 a kilowatt is a very good projection of the price. So here's a weight, the PVs, most of the weight. So we're looking at about third weight of the internal combustion engine, maybe less. It's about 100 kilograms for our average range of sizes. Pretty much the only difference is we'd use the same base and we just go with different domes. So here's one dome that on the first generation we'd be running around 50 kW, and then this one would be running around 150 kW. And then we go to the higher temperature, that could go up to 300 kilowatts. So we're going to run at lower temperature initially. That's electric. So enormous global markets in the fuels. This is just fossil fuel, $8 trillion. That was in 2013. Came down a little bit, but it's not that low. Electricity continues to go up. We're predominantly electricity company. There's $1 trillion a year in annual infrastructure spend. The energy demand is continuing to go up, and renewables are only going to satisfy a small portion of that. If you look at global electricity, it's 3.5 billion. And if we charge 5 cents a kilowatt hour, we'd be about a $1.5 trillion market for the SunCell. You look at the levelized cost of all other forms of electricity, not counting demand charges, transmission and distribution, which could be as much as generation, we're a lower price than any other form of energy. So if you look at the U.S. electricity market, it's $387 billion, and the average cent is about 10 cents per kilowatt hour. We would cut that in half and give twice the capacity. So you could, if you ran full out on the equipment under the lease, you have your electricity about 25% of your current rate. So these are the different costs of other forms of power for generation. It doesn't include transmission and other charges. So you can see residential in the U.S. is a pretty big market. It's smaller in other countries, or in other words, it's bigger in the U.S. because we don't have much industry. It's all been moved offshore, but in other countries, commercial is a bigger market. We're looking at large commercial industrial markets as our initial entry point, and then large residential, which like apartment buildings. So here's how it works. We have a light bulb inside of a photovoltaic converter, and just like I showed here. So this is made of tungsten, and it's the same temperature as we're going to run. So you can imagine that filament and its entire bulb. So we're looking at many orders of magnitude more area. So this is 150 watt electric. So on a relative basis, we would have 150,000 watts of electricity. So, and then the conversion efficiency, if you go 30%. So we're more like 300,000 times more area emitting to get what that light is producing. So the other thing is the sun is radiating these panels here without being concentrated. So in this case, we would have the very, very high intense light, 2,000 times what you typically have from the sun. So it converts that light into electricity, and particularly it's a form of light. It's a like something called black body radiator. It means it's not specific atomic lines or molecular lines. It's a whole continuum of wavelengths that are matched, or vice versa. The photovoltaic cells match the particular wavelengths of the light that we generate in the cell. And we've done a lot of advancement of this. In particular, here's what we got done. We have the theory solved. We have a lot of intellectual property. We have the light source demonstrated. It's certified by 5 validators. We have 4 different methodologies. We have the photovoltaic cells are designed. We have 3 suppliers right now. And we have what they call the dense receiver array. That's the assemblage of all the photovoltaic cells into a package. It's a geodesic dome that goes around the black body radiator. We have, and also it's called the dense receiver array that uses these cells, these concentrator photovoltaic cells in that packaging. We have the black body radiator design, commercial engineering drawings, and then from that we can get our cost of bill of materials. And we have, as you see here, light source prototype, and you're going to see more of that today in video and in real time. So we have the apparatus, and it produces extremely high energy light, as I showed here. You can't directly photovoltaic convert that, so we absorb it into this dome right here, and then it comes out looking like this. So rather than this kind of spectrum in the very short wavelengths, it has this very broad spectrum that matches the photovoltaic conversion spectrum. So this is the efficiency of the photovoltaic versus wavelength, and we match these up so we get very, very high conversion efficiency. This is a commercial product. So these concentrator photovoltaics, including the cooling system, are commercial devices working in the field at a very large scale, 10 megawatt type scale. And there's an infinite production capacity. And I'll go over all the different things that we're taking from known technologies. The implementation of known technology is very critical here. We're using everything that we need to solve, we're taking out of industry. We haven't found a single problem we haven't been able to solve yet that doesn't lend itself to using something that's already known and proven. And I'll come back to the photovoltaic production as another example. Like the LED industry got saturated very quickly because there's something called the MOCVD fabricating equipment that can be made very, very quickly. The same type of equipment that we can adopt to use for our process of making chips or photovoltaic cells for our converter. So this is a schematic. It's a very schematic form. It has a geodesic dome. You can see there's triangular elements. It makes it very convenient to scale this dome to different sizes, and thereby convert power at higher power levels or smaller power levels depending on the radius of the dome. It has a, that was borrowed from the photovoltaic industry, in particular the concentrator photovoltaic industry. And what's really critical here is these cooling plates. You can go to 10,000 suns without trouble. It's the problem is that taking away the heat. What power is not converted to electricity, you have to reject the heat. And that was solved by something called electric discharge machining to make microchannel plates, cold plates, for these photovoltaic cells. And they are working in the lab now at 10,000 suns, albeit we're going to go, we're going to shoot for 2,000 suns for our initial prototypes. So we borrowed that from concentrator photovoltaic industry, the MOCVD we borrowed from the LED and other chip fabrication industry. The supercapacitors are from the energy storage industry. This inductively coupled heater, as you can see here, goes in and heats up silver in this reservoir. That was borrowed from the metals and heating industry. The refractory materials is tungsten. This is all tungsten. That was borrowed from aerospace and incandescent lighting industry. The halogen cycle, the redeposit, the vapor pressure or vapor vaporized silver, or excuse me, vaporized tungsten from this dome, redeposited with the halogen complex with tungsten. That was developed by the incandescent lighting industry. And then the all the cooling system, the electromagnetic pump, that was industry cooling system. Electromagnetic pump was borrowed from the nuclear industry. So all these parts we've gotten from industry that we were able to adopt for our particular use. Yeah, Jim, I'll get questions right at the end. So this is looking at, let me show you one important part of it. So the way this works is the main heart of it is something that has no moving parts. It's called electromagnetic pump. It has magnets on this axis. These blocks are magnets. There's little yokes on the end that direct the magnetic field into this pipe that's vertical here. And the metal flows through this pipe. The current comes in vertically here, and this metal, this section right here, is in cross section, and it's coming out towards us. So the current comes down on this vertical axis, the magnetic field's on this transverse axis, the metal's pumped in a plane perpendicular to the current and the magnetic field. So it's coming out of the page at us, goes around a loop, and then goes vertically up through this nozzle, injects in these electrodes, and they're connected to the supercapacitors, and when that molten metal goes between those electrodes, it completes the circuit, and you get a high current blast. It has in it, incorporated in it, initially we were running water entrainment with the, oh, they're ready? Okay, you want to go back to that? I'll come back to that. Water entrainment, and we have another method now of incorporating the fuel.
Okay, when you rerun the spectrum, previous one had a wrong timing. Three, two, one, go. Okay, you can see we have a two major peak starting from 100 nanometer to 350 nanometer, and this spectrum has five times of the energy that acquired by the previous experiment, because the previous experiment was started 200 nanometer and above, and we have a major peak below 200 nanometer. It has more intensity and has more energy than the small peak. So we have five times more of the previous one. The next one we're ready prepared to the CD-ROM. Once we are ready, we'll let you know. Thank you.
Yeah. So what he's showing is the light is predominantly in the extremely high energy region. So he's generating a spectrum there live to show that, and then we match that up with the National Institutes and Standards and Technologies calibrated light source, and we can tell the optical power over the UV, the extreme ultraviolet, and the extremely short wavelength region, so he can give you the total optical power out. So they're working that up now with the calorimetric results and getting the SunCell ready to demonstrate. So they'll come back with that. So as I was saying with the water, so we are entraining water in this injection. So we had a source of the catalyst, which is a nascent or a isolated, non-chemically bound, as if it were in space in total isolation, water molecule plus atomic hydrogen is what makes this reaction propagate. So we have to generate HOH, not hydrogen bound, not bulk state, not even dimers of steam. And so now the way we're doing that, to avoid building up water pressure inside here, that limits the reaction. As you build up more and more water, it actually shuts the reaction off. And it's got very, very low tolerances for excessive water vapor pressure. So now we're injecting, entrained in that metal stream, an extremely, extremely stable oxide. But in the high power plasma, some of those oxygen atoms are broken off and they react with hydrogen that we're adding as a diluted mixture in a noble gas. Again, you get too much hydrogen, it won't work either. There's a very small tolerance ranges for this that we've worked out. So we flow that in there, and when this plasma ignites, it creates oxygen atoms, react with the hydrogen we're flowing through, and makes the catalyst, and together with the atomic hydrogen, we get extremely, extremely high powers. So, and there's extremely high variability depending on what that oxide source is. I mean, some of these things are just outrageously powerful, and other ones really don't work at all. So what you're going to see is ones that work, obviously. So let me go back to the electromagnetic pump. So this is one of the first ones we made. That's why I like to show this. And this is an industry product. They use them for pumping metals in liquid metals and chemical processes and coolant in nuclear plants and things like that. But these blocks here are a chunk of iron, really high purity iron. And you guys ever work with magnets? You put a piece of iron, it's really super, super magnetic. So we have a magnet on the back of that and super magnetizes this. So there's a magnetic field, and that can stand a really high temperature before it loses its magnetization. But if you heat this magnet up hot, then it just won't be a magnet anymore. So we have coolant plates here. This cools the magnet. These are water cooling jackets. So we get this magnetic field this way, and we're running current this way. So remember the plane, so it's going to pump out perpendicular to the magnetic field and the current. So it's going to come out towards you. So we heat up some metal, and we put it through the pump. And this is an older design we showed last demonstration, January 28th. So but I just want to show you. Here's a copper coil that goes around the cell. Now it's pretty much, this is a cell, and then we have a dome on top of it replacing this. So we're going to go just with the UV radiation. This would just radiate out to the PV panel up there. We're working on those high energy light converting photovoltaics. And it's yet to be seen whether they're going to be superior, because we can use infrared reflectors on the ordinary ones. So we're, but I just want to show that coil. This is where we pick up the heat to measure the power coming out of the what we call the CG, it's a variant of the SunCell. We call it continuous generator. These water lines here are for cooling the magnets of the electromagnetic pump. So this is what it looks like. And you can turn the current up and down. Has no moving parts. This is a molten silver. It melts at 962 centigrade. And then it goes maintenance-free. These things are in the field maintenance-free 60 years. And they're still going. So this is a very, very elegant way of making the reaction go. So now you add electricity to it, and you get this. So this is kind of one of more newer generation with that oxide. This is a glove box, so this is human size. This is where your hands go in of a glove box. So it's not something small, it's big. That's a vaporized silver that is a white smoke. It's vaporizing metal. So it's getting really, really hot in there, to tell you at least. And I'll show you hot. That's hotter when it goes in white flashes. That's hotter than the surface of the sun. That's black body plasma, hotter than the surface of the sun. So I'll show you what's going on there. So we had the first one, we had that kind of green light. That's a high energy light. And then when the silver gets vaporized, and you'll see particles streaming down, they're silver particles coming out of the ignition. And they have streamers like asteroids coming off of them. That's because it's being vaporized. And once you get vapor, the short wavelength light can't penetrate through anymore. So it absorbs all that high energy light. So when you see that visible light, you're only seeing a very small fraction of power. Remember I said essentially no power in the visible and infrared, essentially all really short wavelength lights, wavelength light. So this is this will absorb that light, and then it'll create what they call a black body light, because it's absorbing, it's optically thick. So we'll come back to that and show you that. So we're going to go back to the CG now. It's ready to go. All right, we're going to pull that up. Now, there'll be a while. They're just warming it up and turning on the pump. So it might take a while. We'll just see if it's going to go right away or not. Okay, so we're live now, back in the lab. He has an inductively coupled heater on, so that's where it's glowing. This is insulation, and then the top of the cell is here. It's going to be open, so you can see it. And he's melting the silver and warming it up so the electromagnetic pump will come active. As soon as it becomes active, it hits the electrodes, and it'll start igniting. And then he'll adjust the operating parameters to get it up to high power. So it might take a while, so I figured I'd do some question Q&A while we're waiting on that. So we got any other questions? Yes, go ahead.
What is the conversion efficiency between plasma emission and black body radiation?
100%. Yeah. We lost feed? Okay, there it is. Go on a different camera angle?
Yeah, that's the same one.
Okay. All right.
So yeah. In the glove box shot that you had in the second shot, the frequency of that noise, what was driving that? Is that actually the ignition
process?
Yes.
Right. Yeah, I can't go into the details of that.
Did that have a silver fountain operation as well?
Yeah, same design. Yeah, just different operating parameters. And the input power of the electrodes, oh, here it goes.
What's on the glove footprint?
Did he lose electrode? All right. Okay, there it is. We'll come back and we'll show you how much power that is. He'll have the electrode. He'll have the electrode power in. That's a lot of power. So that's one part of this meeting is we're going to give you the quantification of how much power that is. Now he was intermittently doing it, or it just melt right through the thing in seconds. So he's turning it on and on, and like that lamp, it allows it to cool down, or it would just fry very, very quickly. So it gives us parameters, and then we can build it in the refractory system and run that continuously under those extremely high power conditions. So I can show you another example of how high a power that is. So this is where we're converting it from this scenario on the left, where you see essentially very little amount of light, to the scenario on the right, where it's hotter than the surface of the sun. This is a black body that fills the entire glove box. Glove box is where you go in and work inside a chamber, and you put your hands inside. So this is big. This is not some small miniature lab apparatus. And what this is showing the spectrum. It starts out, this is a very, very small part of the spectrum that Ying showed, and particularly, actually this is the one we showed in that, we'll show in the first spectrometer that goes down to just the ultraviolet. The window cuts this off. A window is, like any kind of window, light can go through, and then there's other frequencies that can't go through. And in this case, it cuts it off at 180 nanometers. So this is ultraviolet, and then you get into, so we're catching some ultraviolet here, and then you go to even shorter wavelengths, it won't go through that window. It cuts it off. But you can see there's lines here, and then it transitions going from right to left, these very, very smooth curves. These are what they call black body radiator curves. And where you look at where this radiation, which range this covers and where the peak is, you can tell what the temperature is. And down to 200 nanometers corresponds to about 6,000 degrees Kelvin, which is hotter than the surface of the sun. So this is showing the supercapacitors up on top igniting it. We have an inductively coupled heater that has an applicator full of silver that we're melting it, and we're dripping it down into tungsten electrodes. And you can see particles of silver, and then they'll be streaming, or they're boiling as they're falling. You can see now the vapor. Silver vapor, it's vaporizing the silver. Eventually it vaporizes all of it. It's so much power, it vaporizes all the metals flowing in there, and it's absorbing that short wavelength light and converting it into black body radiation. So now that high energy light can't penetrate it, it's all absorbed, and you just see a runaway thermal event where it just gets enormously hot and extremely powerful in terms of the volume and the amount of radiation coming off of that. So all this white smoke is vaporized metal. So you can look at the black body curve, and we can tell the temperature from where the spectrum matches that to the spectrometer's recording on that device. And even if you go at 5,000 degrees Kelvin, that's 35 million watts per square meter. I mean, that's a lot of power coming from that surface. And that can match up pretty well with photovoltaic converters. And particularly what we want to run is somewhere between 3,700, which will give us around 11 million watts per square meter, to say 3,000, which will give us around 4.6 million watts per square meter. So then we can size our dome proportionally. Okay, well, good. We're going to go back and analyze some data now. Then I'll get back to the engineering.
Okay. Hello. Welcome back, everyone. I'm back at the calorimeter station, and up on your screen, you should see the completed thermal trace. You saw it rising as we left, and it continued to rise and crested over. And what we do is we take this data, and we process it with the standard procedures that the PAR bomb calorimeter gives, split it into a pre, a post slope, and the temperature rise, and calculate the thermal energy out, which in this case was 440 joules, approximately. And from the signal that we acquired on the data acquisition, we process that, both from the decay current of the disruption and we have a total input energy of about 144 joules. And so the total energy balance is 440 joules out thermal, 144 in, for a gain of about 3.06, and a net of 296 joules approximately in. Now this disruption was on the order of 0.75 milliseconds. So the implied power of that many joules over that time duration is about 392 kilowatts. The power input during the disruption was about 12.6 joules for about an implied input energy during the blast of about 17 kilowatts. So that's about that's the conclusion for the calorimetry. We will change stations back to the MITx and review the data from the spectroscopy that we acquired there earlier. I'll be back with you in a moment.
All right, so he's getting, typically we get somewhere between 300 and 600 kilowatts out with about 25 kilowatts in. So he's getting numbers somewhere in the ballpark of that range. So the, and then he'll go over what the power balance is for the spectroscopy as well. So there's the dome, and then we've worked out how to fabricate in high temperature materials all the different nuances of the design in terms of how to make the pump and the penetrations and the all the different fasteners to put together the cell to run at these extremely high temperatures. We have the engineering drawings down to extremely high detail that the you could do computer-aided manufacturing. So I just want to give you some examples of some of the intricacies of how this thing has been advanced to commercial engineering. So in particular, we're going to have, this is the dome. So this would be, depending on what temperature, we run at 3,000. It's going to be around 150,000 watt electric. We worked out how to have penetrations, have the electrical feed-throughs that operate up to 3,700 degrees to the melting point, 3,700 Kelvin. The electrical connectors, how to fabricate the electromagnetic pump and all the pieces and the connectors to go into the reservoir, and how to assemble this thing from those high temperature refractory materials. So there's a lot of design work went in that. Another challenge was we're going to have the silver in here in this dome at much higher than the boiling point of silver. So there was another design element that built into this the ability to run this thing at the withstand the high vapor pressure that we're going to develop inside this dome from that silver basically boiling. The other one was we have a solution using the halogen cycle. So we run this at extremely high temperatures. Any metal vapor that comes off this that would then deposit a thin film onto the window and therefore block the PV, is that's been solved by the halogen cycle that you have in the halogen lamp technology. So there, that's just examples. There's many, many engineering challenges, and so far they have been solved, and we have extremely well-proven, learned out engineering industry engineering experience that we've adopted for those solutions. Okay, we'll go through that. We're going to go through some more data. Do you have his voice? Well, sound.
All right, can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. All right, so we are back at the MITx spectrometer station now, and we have taken the dark sample data and the sample signal that we acquired earlier and plugged in all the appropriate parameters to do this calculation. And when we take a look and review the data, we see actually that some of the signal saturated the detector, which means this is a little bit conservative from that perspective. But the overall power of the temporal profile, you can see peaked out at approximately 0.25 megawatt, roughly 723 kilowatts. And the total energy from that blast was approximately 154 joules. And the time average spectra of that emission is pretty much all in the UV. This spectrometer goes down to 200 nanometers and not below, which is why we don't see anything below that. And the time normalized power was roughly 160 kilowatts over roughly 1 millisecond of emission. Now, based on what Dr. Liu was saying earlier, we're not seeing a lot of the emission short of 200 nanometers, and that's roughly holds roughly 5 times more energy than what we're seeing here. So if we actually take those numbers and multiply by approximately 5, we get a peak power of about 3.6 megawatts over the whole wavelength region, and an energy of 770 joules, and roughly 800 kilowatt time normalized. So now we'll need another couple minutes, but the CG data is being processed, and we will return once we have that completed.
Yes.
Can you repeat the part of how you get rid of the silver wafer so that it won't block the photovoltaic cell?
I just said we have a way of solving that. It's extremely elegant, so I can't tell exactly what it is, but that would be a question that someone would have, but we have an extremely elegant way to handle that. So this is a prototype that we ran. I'm just showing a mock-up of it here just so you can see some of the parts. We have the black body radiator. We have the penetrations for the electrodes. There's a certain electrode design we use. We have heat transfer blocks. That would transfer heat from the reservoir, and this would be heated with the inductively coupled heater only to start it up, and then it would transfer heat down to keep this pump tube hot, and then we have the magnets here. There's blocks here for water cooling, and then we have busbar connectors to the busbar connectors to the busbars that power up the electrodes, and then we can have different dome sizes and different PV or dense receiver array sizes for the different powers that we want to develop. So we're looking to make a 10 kW, and then this would be 50 going on somewhere between 100 to 150, depending on the temperature. That'd be 150 going on up to 300 and higher, depending on what temperature and emissivity we run the dome. So this is some of the plumbing that for the water cooling, and these are some of the plumbed up water cooling blocks for the magnets. There's some ceramic insulation that goes around that. This coil is the inductively coupled coil to heat it up, start it. These are water cooled bus bars going into the electrodes. And then there'll be a dome that goes on that, as you can see here. Penetration for the electrodes. And then there's very, very unique sealing technology that we developed that will go up to as high as the melting point of tungsten. This is a vacuum chamber, so we would put this inside a vacuum chamber when we're in a commercial design. And this is a device, again, the black body radiator, the electrodes, the silver reservoir, the electromagnetic pump. It's pretty straightforward, very simple, very elegant design, but there's a lot of intricacies that runs this at very high silver vapor pressure, and another issue is the means to fabricate that. You can see different types of mechanical connectors and different technologies we use in terms of connecting all these parts for the type of materials. It's a very elegant solution. So we're going to show you the operation of the cell. So this is inside the glove box again, and this is that dome, the black body radiator dome. So we're heating it up to start it up with the inductively coupled heater. And then we have a very small charge of hydrogen. That's really important. This thing makes a lot of power when it's close, and it makes a lot of energy per hydrogen charge. He's reading off the pump temperature. We have to keep it above the melting point pump. All right, so it makes a ton of power when it's closed up, which is a good thing. The silver vapor pressure gets high, and it makes a lot of energy. It's got the ability to go, the hydrogen atoms can go under a transition, and then they can go to the subsequent lower transition. So you saw at the end, it got actually glow, the top glow, dome got the glow really high without adding any more hydrogen. It went kind of accelerated in power and melted. So that's a good feature. On the next one. So we feel we're on our timeline. We have the closed system, and we're working to make it out of refractory materials, which will be the next step. We have the engineering drawings. We have the concentrator photovoltaic cells designed, and we're 4 months away from the fab of that. And then that get integrated with the light source that's made out of refractory material, and then we can start doing field trials. So then quickly after that, go into manufacturing. So it's saying everything here can be mass produced and fabricated with existing tooling, and that tooling can be scaled up very quickly. So we'll talk about the launch in the commercial markets. So rather than the central gen model, where you have high cost of electricity, a lot of transmission and distribution costs, a lot of infrastructure intense, and CO2 impact and other pollution issues. Then you got the grid with the its inherent vulnerabilities and costs. So the you add that up, that's equivalent to the cost of generation in many cases. So as I said, we're going to reinvent electricity as autonomous, completely off-grid, mass-produced, personal power, like a personal computer, and go completely away from the central model. We'll do a flat per diem lease, no metering, and we'll add redundancy in case there's an interruption. And unlike a catastrophic event like a hurricane where you have hundreds of thousands of people potentially knocked out with a loss of power, for days, weeks, months, in the case of Sandy. This will be very sporadic, very, very minor in impact, and we can quickly go out and replace the cell. So you don't have power lines going down because everyone will have their own personal power. So I would think it's even more reliable than the grid, because you're going to have backup power, and we can come out and fix it really fast. We'll have depot repair centers, and we can just dispatch another unit, and they're really small, so we could just switch it out. So we're going to do behind meter initially, and then go to a global push of completely off-grid. So this would be our customer base where these lights are. Our initial customer base. So then we looked at the urban grid. And the urban grid, even at 1 to 2 cents a kilowatt hour, if you transmit, say, from one Broadway to two Broadway in New York City, that's even 10 times more than having redundant cells. So with this particular technology, which is unique to it, it doesn't make any sense to be on the grid at all. The wires and the transformers and the control that are much more expensive than just having a redundancy of cells. And you avoid regulatory issues. So, and the transmission, distribution, and demand charges. So if you're off, not connected to grid, then there's no regulation. There's underwriters, labs, and local permitting. And we have multiple major electrical contractors that do up to $1 billion a year of revenue. And they would install the cells for us. So they would be our install, maintenance, and repair infrastructure. So we could very quickly get into power in a major way by outsourcing manufacturing, supply chain management, and then the install maintenance, and we would only be doing leasing. That'd be our core competency and focus. So we're going to go big power and then work our way down. So we have some of the parameters. It's going to be pretty light. On average, say about 100 kilograms or a couple hundred pounds. We can wire it to anything that photovoltaic solar farms are wired to now, because that's what it is, solar. So then it would be inputted in inverters, and then eventually the world would go DC, and you won't need inverters. But the power output would be the same as what consumers are used to now. The other thing is we can have extraordinarily fast response time, because we're just going to keep it at full power and just dump any power you're not losing. Again, you got to use the idea of wasting power. It's kind of a hard concept, but it's so cheap to make, it's irrelevant. So we would have telemetry to monitor this. There's an interesting application there as well, because we're going to have essentially everywhere that power is consumed, in homes and stores and businesses and cars, we're going to have a unit, and the unit's going to be hooked to the cloud, and then we can make our own cloud, our own internet. We can transmit additional data other than monitoring the cell and sending commands to the cell. So that's another business in its own right, but nonetheless, we're going to have the ability to see what's going on with every cell and make sure the thing is reliable and operating up to standards. But this is kind of the basic initial scheme. So we'd have inverter and then into your electrical panel and go to your conventional loads. But most loads these days are DC. The only reason why everything's AC makes any sense is because of transmission. Once you eliminate the need for transmission, it actually is much more superior to go DC. Because most products actually take AC and convert it to DC, like your computer and your TV and your motors and things like that. So we're going to go from heavy power down to small, and then same in terms of what markets we go after in terms of which countries and the like. There's some niche markets that are easy, that are attractive for initial rollout, like quick serve restaurants use a ton of power, like Wendy's or Taco Bell or McDonald's and the like, Burger King. So the we were thinking about putting somewhere between 10 and 250 kW in there, depending on what scale. I think we're going to go with 100. Looks like we're going to go for like 120 kW initial scale. Then we give them base load power, and then and there'd be no net metering. We'd just give them base load power, and they'd consume more than that. And they actually use quite a lot of power, and it's very expensive. It'd save them about $100,000 a year if we give them power at 5 cents a kilowatt hour. Then we show reliability, and we can take them and other customers off grid once we establish reliability of the of the product and the technology. So they'll have backup power until we do the learn out. And there's some states you can do that. You can do the connect and you just don't do back metering, that is sell power back to the utility. You just give them baseload power and they'll have the utility wire there. Then once it's learned out, then we'll just switch them off the grid. So then we're going to, once we get the reliability established, we'll do large industrial, commercial, and then big residential. Again, no metering, per diem lease, based on their capacity to suit their historical and anticipated maximum load. So we'll give them twice the capacity, so one goes out, they'll still have the same peak capacity they had historically, and we'll come out and fix it. And then we'll have a fast demand response from that. So they have a ramp up, a ramp down. We'll have the capacity there to serve that. And then we have the redundancy and avoid disruption. And we're going to put smart controls on this as well. So in the residential, there's certain niche markets in terms of usage. Like Florida, they use a lot more electricity, as you can imagine, for air conditioning. Then people that are super, super rich, they use a lot more electricity, as you can imagine, with the super big homes. And those are some initial target residential, and then ultimately doing all residential with independent units. So one of the issues is how much capacity you have to use, and how much is it getting utilized. One way we could cut down on the capital investment is to use smart metering, because heating, air conditioning, water heating is about 75% of home demand. So if you don't turn everything on in that category simultaneously, you can actually use a lot less power. So, and we'll have those smart systems in our power source. So look at adoption rates. You look at the cell phone as an example. So by 2002, mobile was surpassed 125-year-old landline industry. By 2014, it's 1.1 trillion, five times landline users. So it had so it goes from like 250 million to 2.6 billion over from 2008 to 6-year time span, 49% compounded annual growth rate. So this is it's kind of analogous. We have no landline, so we have no infrastructure like in the case of utilities. We wouldn't use a grid. We would have autonomous power. Same with phone. They're just using wireless. Or put it another way, we've looked at adoption rates much less than this, and the proliferation of the technology and the revenue is astronomical. I mean, it sets a new precedent in terms of a business and a business possibilities. So then we look at oil. We'll look at that's predominantly transportation fuel. And it represents about 27% of the global energy usage. So we're predominantly electric business, but this is an attractive business as well. There's 700 million passenger cars, and this could be an enormous market, except the utilization is quite small. And it could actually go up quite a bit more when you get into to Uber services and higher utilization when they have vehicle sharing, and we'll go into that a bit. So you have the cell again; it'd be the same cells used for stationary. And I was asked about whether the PV, whether it was resilient enough, and they tell me they make space-based power sources. And there's nothing on this planet where a human could withstand that kind of pounding and acceleration, and this works fine. So the PV is extremely resilient, can take enormous vibration and acceleration, like a rocket launch kind of circumstances or conditions, and survive that. So we would have, basically, we could run all DC. Because most of the motors, the Prius and the Leaf and the like, are all DC-based power sources. So then we look at motive. Our big target is the heavy trucks and buses. And if you look at annual production, it's greater than the European Union existing electrical generation. Then in light vehicles, there's 86 million autos and light trucks per year, and that's two times existing global electricity generation. So it's huge, huge amount of power. Then there's other markets beyond that. So we look at trucks and buses initially, and I'll go through the rank order here, hierarchy of market targeting. So most of the cars are in U.S., Europe, Asia, and the production is 86 million cars and 18 million light-duty trucks. Freight trucks are what's really lucrative to us because they are used very, very substantially, and they're higher power. So it's 3.8 million units per year. It's 22% of the global transportation energy usage. And right now there's a big push to electrify buses, but then you need a really, really big charger. Like you need a charger that has as much power or more power than the Transamerica building in San Francisco consumes. So that means you have to get all kinds of permitting and make all kinds of infrastructure, and you got all kinds of demand charges, and it really drives the cost of electric bus charging off the map. So we could drop in a SunCell and charge buses without any infrastructure, without any grid regulation, any demand charges. We cut the market dramatically for that application. Now batteries are actually much more expensive than the SunCell for both buses, trucks, and for cars, and all those are being electrified now. But because of the attractiveness of the high utilization, that's actually an initial attractive short-term market. And then ultimately, even passenger vehicles will go direct SunCell to electric motor, and they give you an idea what the prospects is there. You can go over 1,000 miles on a liter of water using the energy balance for the most conservative hydrino reaction and using the energy consumption of the Model S Tesla. So again, for those vehicles, they are quite a good opportunity to use charging stations for existing electric vehicles and then build out the platform to displace the batteries with our SunCell. But you get high utilization and therefore high revenue per SunCell. If we charge 5 cents a kilowatt hour, it would cut the cost of charging electric vehicles about in half, and we would derive substantial revenue from that. Now, this is an interesting prospect. You look at motive to stationary. This is an enormous, enormous potential market. So everybody who's entrepreneurial should be thinking of a power application. You know, have a phone application, so now you need a power application. So in particular, if you look at individual power consumption, it's about a kilowatt power per individual. And average it out about a kilowatt per household. You look at how much cars there are. There's 280 million cars in the U.S., 2.5 million heavy trucks, and 77.5 million light trucks. That works out to 120 kilowatts, or 120 times the amount of power that an individual typically uses on average. So that means you're only using the vehicles 1.5% of their capacity. So that means they got to be doing other things. In fact, if you look at 4 months of car production, that would fully meet all the electrical demands of the U.S. So there's a lot of other things you can use power for, and it'll make a lot of industries very, very profitable. And you can use it for desalinization, and you can use it for water purification, and you can use it for aluminum, and high power transportation applications and the like. So there's going to be a lot of benefit in those areas of industry. Another application that kind of bridges the motive and the stationary is is refrigeration on cargo, freight trucks, cargo vessels and the like, on ships and trains that ultimately go on the freight. And those refrigeration units are right in the size range of a 10 kW that we're projecting to make. And then we got rail. Rail, we would power electrified lines, again, like SEPTA and Amtrak, and all those could benefit from our power source, and then ultimately put the SunCell on any form of rail. Right now there's 8% of the world's passengers and goods move on rail, and there's electrification. About one-third of the tracks now are electrified. You can electrify all rail with the SunCell. The market is about $31 billion a year. And you talk about a drug and you say, well, you got a $1 billion market, everybody gets really excited. I mean, we look at a small market as $31 billion. So then you got cargo ships and then moving down to even yachts and motorboats and things like that, pleasure craft. So about as big as it gets, and actually the sweet spot for marine is about 2 MW. So we're making a 250 kW, it'd be like 8 of those units. You gang them together. It's very easily done. And it gives you redundancy and reliability. Because this engine breaks down, you're kind of sunk out there in the Somalia pirates getting you. And ours, you'd still have all your electrical, most of it, you'd still be functional. So anyhow, they have the hotel load, and they're sort of half a megawatt type scale. That's to run all the refrigeration and other what they call a hotel load is the other electrical consumption on board ship, and like two of our 250K units, maybe four would meet that market very nicely. Again, $24 billion a year. It's a very interesting market. It's high utilization, and they're used to leasing equipment, like they lease ships per nautical mile and things like that. So the model works pretty well. So this is showing some projections. The interesting thing about this graph is it's like compounding interest back when banks paid interest. Now they take money away from you, keep your money there. It's very unusual. But here we would compound the number of cells. We keep adding cells. But those other cells are still out there for 20 years. So it just keeps accumulating, and the revenues go the same way. They go up exponentially with time. So as I was saying, our model is to outsource. So we would have design engineers, and then we would have contract manufacturers, and they would do supply chain management, they do depot repair centers in terms of parts, and then do the manufacturing, of course. And then we'd have other partners do install, do the maintenance, whatnot, and then in between there, if we need any auxiliary equipment like inverters, we're talking to a number of companies that said they'd supply all the inverters we need. That's another thing we borrowed from industry is the inverters. And they rely on IGBT technology, which is another semiconductor industry borrow. So a lot of technology that's really super cutting edge is going into the SunCell. Like we're getting the best of everything, even down to telemetry and all the electronics and the power conversion in this. So it's not the old dinosaur smoking, boiling, steaming electrical dice. This is super, super high tech, barring all this industry knowledge and capacity. So then distribution is going to be mostly our area where we have these functions, and we do the leasing of per diem leasing for power equipment. And, of course, innovation. We'll have continue to innovate. So these are some of the functions we're adding as our build out. And then they kind of summarize here. So incredibly cheap and versatile and autonomous. One of the other interesting things is unlike solar where you have to try and pay it off over a very, very long time span, and there's change of ownership issues and things like that, we can charge a install fee and it'll pay it off. The install fee would be about the cost of the capital equipment and it can be paid off in less than 90 days. So there isn't this long overhang of finance and finance issues because extremely small cost, no fuel cost, and the versatility of this. And you don't need a grid connection when the sun goes down or wind's not blowing and things like that. So that's a very, very big plus. You don't need redundancy in power plants. So we're going to outsource and manage our technology partners and end users with very limited risk. And we have a partnership-based value chain for speed so we can get to market quickly and leverage existing infrastructure. We have independence of regulatory issues by going off-grid. And there's also the issue of no CO2 or no pollution of any kind. And it allows to expand in markets beyond where I showed those lights, where the world's lit up. If you look at the world, there's a lot of it that's not lit up. And there's something like a couple billion people without electricity. And this is about the only thing that can be as facile and adaptive to that kind of rapid deployment and cost and proliferation without infrastructure. So that's a big potential for that. So we got the summarize. We got new sustainable non-polluting energy. We're going to be the electricity company of the future and have really great relationships with suppliers and installers and all our support and of course our customers. And we have enormously competitive position and extremely, unmatched value proposition for the customer. So it's off-grid, free of any fuels infrastructure, and any of the regulation and tariffs and transmission and distribution, all these other ancillary charges. And we're transitioning now to a product. We're working on product launch the first half of 2017, and we're licensing and making contracts with suppliers and manufacturers and doing hires and building out the company to achieve our goals into 2017. So I'll take questions at this point. Yes?
Your inverted pyramid showing the stationary installation with commercial users, capital residential, and so on, and also the inverted pyramid for mobile installation with freight trucks and so on. What is the timeline on that?
We actually are talking to there's two tiers of a pathway. One of them is that we're talking to a truck manufacturer that makes trucks for household name companies, and we're going to get their input into how long it would take. But the idea is once we have a cell, it could be integrated fairly rapidly. So we're going to take an existing electric vehicle platform and transition it away from batteries, or maybe even do a hybrid intermediate and then evolve it to pure SunCell driven. So it's basically the timeline to get the SunCell of about 250 kW plus whatever the integration time is with the vehicle. We're working out those details right now. It shouldn't be too lengthy. I would say it would happen within a year because it's basically taking an existing platform and then and adapting it for our technology. Yeah. Oh, Al.
Can you tell us about the annual maintenance costs? I think you said $1.20 kilowatt in maintenance. Is this going to be your operating expense, or is this going to be an expense on the income statement of a channel partner that's deploying the equipment? And if so, can you help us explain the business model of the channel that helps deploy this equipment and maintains it? What are they going to be compensated for? Have you thought about their returns and their profit and loss statements? Thanks.
Yeah. So fundamentally, it's $1.20 or 2% of capital cost based on the solar model, because the main device that would need maintenance would be the solar panel, and that cost would be on our balance sheet. In fact, we don't have enough on our balance sheet. We just have a lease, and we just have this incredible amount ramping up revenue. So, so we would pay for the manufacturer, and we would compensate manufacturers. So they're doing like a cost plus, like they have so much for materials and markup, so much for labor and markup, and those are very standard contracts. We hired a very capable individual that ran Ortho Diagnostics to run that for us, done a lot of contract manufacturing, a lot of experience with that. So he's going to be working on those contracts. And then we have an engineering firm and others working on the three photovoltaic manufacturers to do that side of the business. That'll be a turnkey part. So we'll just pay them for whatever the charge is for the capital equipment. And then the installers, we've talked to a number of them. There is actually enormous capacity in the industry for utility industry, that they do a lot of the line maintenance, a lot of line construction, high power transmission lines and transformers, and running installing on poles and things like that. And they do quite a lot of business. Some of those are big. They're like $1 billion a year in revenue. And we met with several, and they would give us they would just charge us so much for installation. So they think they can handle the permitting, and they probably just do a preform pad and put it down and then wire it into the electrical panel, and they would do all that. They would do the installation and come back and do maintenance. So they would just do a bill charge for service, the same way they do utilities, so much per hour or so much per day or so much per unit. We're trying to get it down to so much per unit. Yes.
Excuse me. How do you expect to protect your business model from Japanese and Chinese, and not to mention American competitors?
Well, we're relying very heavily on patents, and one of the advantages of everyone sort of saying, well, we've had a history of rejection of the technology and opposition to the technology based on the quantum mechanics. So scientists have been very negative on it, and some of them have been very activists saying you can't do this because you can't go below the ground state of the hydrogen atom, which they defined in their mathematics by some postulate. And they seem to have influence over industry at that level and at the fundamental research level, and the same with the government. And because of that, we had an extraordinarily advanced lead in patent filing. Like, I can't imagine anyone being able to do this without stepping on our patents. And we're going to enforce those very vigorously. And anyone who develops anything that we later get patents issued, we're going to go and enforce those patents. So I think we have a strong position to dominate in the patent arena, and we plan to enforce those. In fact, the industry partners that we're talking to fully recognize those patents, those enormous portfolio patents we have, and will honor them. So I think we're going to get the major manufacturers, installers, and power users will respect our patents. And we'll be looking to partner up all over the world. We can see a Tokyo office and Shanghai office and Beijing, all over the world. We'll have partners that we'll work with in perpetuity to deliver really high quality, clean energy at extremely cost savings to existing energy sources.
So your lawyers believe that the guts of your business, what makes your business tick, is protected by patents.
Yes, and we're going to rely predominantly on patents, and then we'll establish supply chain. We'll establish partnerships with manufacturers and installers and customer base. So we'll have a very, very large market presence and brand. So we're looking for that for long term. Okay, any other questions?
Yeah. Sorry, John's ready.
Oh, okay, good. Okay, good.
Okay, everyone, we are back at the CG station, and looking at the data, we had a pre-slope of 1.4 E minus 4, a post-slope of 1.65 E minus 2, and that's a ratio of approximately 120 times. And then when we analyze the electrode input power, we have approximately 3.2 kilowatts. The electromagnetic pump input power is 0.8 kilowatts. And the induction heater power is 3.6 kilowatts. The total of the input powers is approximately 7.6 kilowatts. And using this thermal model, we take the 7.6 kilowatt input, multiply it by the slope ratio for a total output power of just a little bit shy of 900 kilowatts. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so in the calorimetry, the optical spectroscopy, and again, the input power for the optical spectroscopy, because of the same instrument igniting it, it's about 25 kilowatt for megawatt power in optical, and then we're getting somewhere around 300,000, and in prior results, we got 600,000 in the calorimeter, with, again, about 25,000 watts of input power, and then here he's putting in nominally less than 10,000 and getting up around megawatt power. The calorimeter is a little bit limited because it's volume constrained, so we always get a little bit lower number there, but the optical and the CG or SunCell are always very similar, and they're in the megawatt power range. So it's so if you look at it in terms of gain, if you're under 10,000 watts and getting a megawatt power, you're up around 100 times gain on power, which is more than adequate that we need at, say, 40% conversion efficiency of thermal photovoltaic into electric. So, more questions?
Yeah. Randy, when do you expect to receive my first refractory material device?
We're getting that bid out to a number of vendors right now. But we have all the designs, and then they've looked at them and said they could build it in those materials. So we're actually they're bidding out and giving us a time frame for that. But we've gotten other parts we've asked them to build, and typically they'll say something like 3 weeks to a month to deliver that.
I have one more question about the control of the vaporization of the tungsten. So I understand your description that in between the photovoltaics.
Yeah, the window, there's a.
Surface will have the halogen. What about inside the chamber? Do you have vaporization of tungsten inside?
We have a solution for that as well.
Okay. Is it a halogen basis or something different?
It's something different. But So this bulb has in it an outer shroud, and inside there is some halogen. Usually it's methyl bromide or dibromomethane, something like that. And then what happens is the tungsten in this bulb, imagine this was the filament. So this whole area is the filament. So it's much, much more power than that, and it's radiating the PV. So the light is actually the same because it's the same temperature. So that halogen bulb and this will be tungsten, and it'll be at the same temperature. So it's identically the same. They're indistinguishable. If you put a PV panel up here, it'll convert that into electricity. So as that is as well, there's very, very minuscule tungsten vapor pressure. Not that you worry about it boiling off and or getting smaller, like the surface getting thinner, but you worry more about the metal depositing on the window where the light's coming out. So it gets a small atomic layer and it'll become opaque so the light can't come out. So they add the halogen gas, and when the tungsten deposits on the window, the halogen gas reacts with it at that cold temperature, makes a complex that's gaseous. It travels to the, or collides, it's just a gas stirring around in there, collides with the hot surface, decomposes, and puts the tungsten back on the metal dome. So that's how a halogen lamp works. And it's very elegant, and it's the basis of the halogen light industry. And you can see the lamp is not a pacifying. So the transport of tungsten shouldn't be a problem to the window. But that window is going to be on the PV converter.
So that's the primary concern is the PV not keeping it opaque.
Right. And this technology works very well for that. Yeah, Jim. Oh, you want to take the microphone, man? Joe, microphone?
Thank you. I just wondered what the noise from this machine would be, say, compared to an internal combustion engine or some other.
Yeah, we're going to have it completely contained. Internal combustion engine, by definition, is an open system. So by definition, you have to have some noise exchange with the environment. So Yeah, it shouldn't be an issue. We're going to have it all. So it would be in a chamber. So it's all sealed up. Hey, John.
Brandy, revenue from energy sources is very important to the governments around the world. How are you going to avoid regulatory traps established to collect money from your invention?
We'll definitely have some activity there. But even if we're taxed at a very high rate, the profit margins are very, very high, and I think it's a win-win for everybody. Because you can generate, well, it's going to save a lot of money in terms of pollution and health, and then all the allocation of money that's going into, say, war. So there'll be a lot of money there to offset any revenue. For example, we won't need all the defense of the Gulf as much as we have now. I mean, a lot of the geopolitical things are resolved. That could be cost saving. You know, we had the peace dividend after the Russians, the Cold War ended, and we kind of started to become more cooperative. That's kind of going the other way a little bit, but still, at the time, it was beneficial because we could scale back on military spending. So there'll be other areas in health and other government expenditure areas that should mitigate some of that. Well, there'll be all those shareholders that have all that capital gain, and they'll be getting super rich from that.
But it basically says that rhodium user charges, for example, is just a perpetual tax. You will have to have some other means to collect revenue for the government. But basically, a satellite system to collect both revenue taxes is very simple to implement. It exists in Germany.
We'll work it out. The government's good at figuring out taxes.
They'll find a way.
Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much. Look forward to having you back again.